Another key word is editor-in-chief. This again is looking at us through the conventional sense, the hierarchy, a editor, a copy editor. I mean, you know, I'm thinking back to Frank Capra and V. Blondo and other movies. I mean, this is a very editor, the cigar movie or that. All these people, that doesn't exist anymore. Actually, even in the conventional media offices, and that's why the circulations are different, because the new media has to be controlled and has to be, you know, they have to expand into it. So that's why flood of such online sites, print, onion, whatever, daily, I don't know, Quartz, Riot, I don't know how that's pronounced. So all these people, they want to expand everywhere. I mean, if they were truly capitalists, they would have sensed this. They would have sensed this advent, because most of the people that most of the Silicon Valley's brains are Indians. So why would the Indians here think of the internet as a kind of, you know, in the Indian media, think of the internet as a kind of challenge? They could have anticipated it, and they could have covered this area off so that, you know, cottoned it off so that, you know, bowlers like us wouldn't enter these places. They have brought in the regulations saying, you know, this there needs to be certain quality control, there needs to be certain, you know, editorial control and all this on the internet. They didn't do it. The Chinese did it, but they did it differently. I mean, the Indians did anticipate it because they're not as, let me put it, they don't have the brains. So, to be capitalist, a truly capitalist, they don't have the brains. We are always, even in this stage when we are sending, you know, other people's satellites through our launch vehicles. You can see the technology employed in various spaces is at least 10 years, 20 years behind. In some farms, and let's say, you know, which are, you know, just the capitalist stage is just entering Bihar and agriculture, and it is making more progress than any other state actually, and Bengal also. Even there, you will find that, you know, the technology is at least 10, 20 years behind the, you know, other states in the same country, like, you know, Maharashtra or Tamil Nadu. So we are always behind, and because this has been from the Neolithic age, this was a deliberate, intentional move that, you know, every import, whether it is cultural or technological, has to be calibrated by, I mean, its entry has to be calibrated and controlled and regulated by the ruling establishment, which is, of course, manned by the Brahmin himself. So, you know, socialism in India was basically about, you know, controlling and regulating technology reaching people, unintended, you know, people. You know, people for whom it is not meant. So this internet also, but the internet went beyond their control, because it is not possible to control it from inside a country. And we were trying to reform at the same time, you know, suddenly committing the sin of, you know, taking up neoliberal reforms. Now even the IMF doesn't like neoliberal. Brought up the research paper recently, a few months ago, I think. Saying neoliberalism has been bad for the world. So what a developing world. So this is some, you know, the most of this world ruling classes, or Indian ruling classes, are full of contradictions. You know, you have this Chidambaram talking of, you know, Modi talking of pakodas, and Chidambaram talking of beggars, which is even worse. So the key word editor-in-chief, we don't have any hierarchy, we don't have any traditional organizational structure. Here's what I jotted down a couple of months ago, and people started asking, what is RTI, what is, you know, what does it do, RTI does this, RTI does. So writers write, editors choose, accept, direct, and copy edit, hold free. This is the conventional media. At the first and final say, it means the writer has to become like an editor, lose his strength, his say. And because liberal democracy, despite what all the liberties they supposedly profess, the editors and the writers, all of them have to follow a certain format, a certain template in the end. So writer becomes the editor, and editor, you know, expands into the writer. And the editor has to become the Brahmin slash capitalist. And a Brahmin slash capitalist has to function as a cop that keeps the caste mode of production going. An organism that has no conscience, no, only an appetite. That's sampradayic or conventional media, or mainstream media. Or values like freedoms, rights, justice, equality that are expressed there have no meaning. Because it's a class without individuals, which means a class which doesn't have any sense of values. But that's the world our detractors live in. How, so how will they understand RTI? A place where the editors don't function in a recognizable hierarchy. At RTI, the writers don't need to lose themselves in the editors. The editors want a world where the Brahmin capitalist doesn't exist. Brahmin slash capitalist. The editors don't choose, select, diet, have the first and final say, or hold sway over everyone else here. They only prove cross copyright it and review in consultation with the writer and very rarely reject anything. It's totally inappropriate to call them editors actually. They do the same work as carpenters, maybe the thieves, leather workers. They perform only a part of many functions that a traditional editor usually does. And none of us smoke cigars. So that's, you know, we only make the copies presentable. So call them carpenters or leather workers or tarzis or malis instead of editors. That's what I call myself. You know, most times I call myself an archivist. I'm not an activist. I call myself a bookkeeper sometimes and also a librarian. I only, you know, place the books in order. I sort them out and place them so that you can come and read. That's this editors is a terminology from a decaying live world. That's not a world where the individual can reach her fullest potential as Babasaheb wanted. So how can you understand RTI if you use tired old conventional lists examined? So this is what we are. We are basically chowkidars, gatekeepers, darzis, carpenters, leather workers. We are the popular. So 500-600 new authors, you know, my friend keeps saying, you know, you every day, you know, Rahul Sonkriple was saying the other day, that, you know, every time you open every day you open RDI, you see a new author. Where did all these people come from, you know? And look at one particular page, the features page in RDI, you will find 12 articles. So 12 articles, around 6 to 8 are usually PhDs and MPhils. And everyone else, and go to Wire or to India Today or to EPW, and please find 6 to 8 PhDs or doctors or engineers, super specialists, doctors. So we are a space which is so filled with brains, but if you Google for RTI, you won't find it. You know, it's difficult to find RTI. So we are such a little space. If there is sort of hierarchy or pecking order, RTI internally among the editors or dharzis or carpenters, one must be incorrigibly cynical to spot it. There is no hierarchy internally as conventionally for the simple reason that we can't afford it. All our editors are volunteers. Relations in any organization in India, formal or informal, are mediated by caste or class or both. But at RTI, all the volunteers are driven by certain intense anti-caste consciousness. We might not have much brains or, you know, as much knowledge or empirical, you know, experience. But all of them are driven by certain consciousness. And we are willing to contribute our own money to run the site. That's what we have done until now. I don't know about the future. I hope, you know, others will step in and find their own ways of, you know, financing it. We are not, you know, we don't have any set formula. We just insist that all, everyone who writes and has a point of view, whether he belongs to a Maoist stream or a Buddhist stream or a Christian stream of Dalits or Bhojan thought, even if he is a Gandhian stream, we'll allow him to speak at our space. It shall be as cacophonous as a railway platform, but we shall ultimately have a final debate wherein some ultimate truth about India and how to solve it. How to solve India, my generation. As I said, if there is a scale of primacy which informs relations at RTI, within RTI, here you have a proud moment. So Rahul also would have felt very proud, but my me sleeping in here is so much of an accident. Her being ignored, Dalit and women and super smart one. So that three problems. So I don't know why or no. But she's a pioneer in so many ways. She persuaded us that this could be done, and then later we all got involved. So then Parambur built up site, and there are other youngsters, Shafi Ulanis, Rovanath, Gaurav Sambanshi, who are contributed in various ways. They are formerly editors, but there are and many others who are sitting here also, who also been, you know, consulting, editing, advising, or you know, critiquing us. So many are here, Nilesh is here. So all these are editors in a certain way. So how will you understand that none of them are paid any salaries, but everyone feels a certain accountability for it. Everyone feels responsible for it. And there is Gurinder Azad, who actually left a job to start Roundtable India in Hindi. He is a published poet in Punjabi and Hindi, and also a filmmaker, and he has worked on Dalit and Adivasi students' issues. So, so these kind of people, how can you say there is no ways to compensate them, and volunteers can't make their demands on each other. And anyway, everyone can make, only persuade the other to contribute some time. If the one persuading doesn't have the time. So volunteers have to believe in trust and good faith and goodwill a lot. So it's a very archaic form of human relationships that exist internally. These are not mediated by caste or cash. And though, I'm from most backward caste, and Shafi is also from Pasmanda caste. Rohanna is a Christian Dalit, Gaurav is a Buddhist Dalit, Bhanu is a Buddhist Dalit, Anu is a, atheist Dalit. So, so this is how we work. I don't know how things happen at Enranch, many media sites. I don't know. I do know Samir Jain, he is actually the herald of the neoliberal age. He was the first one I used to, who started saying, we publish basically advertising and made, and news is something we used to fill in the gaps. And successfully centennial, that's supposedly 150th anniversary in 1990, the late 80s, he celebrated it and totally changed the shape of. It was very staid old newspaper, Times of India. He totally changed it and made it, he was the golden lingo of the media, basically the first one. And I admire his, at least he had the honesty to admit we are all for money and for advertising. We are not here for, changing society or for democracy and all that. So Samir Jain brought back the front page advertisement. Actually, the media actually got born in the neoliberal age around the late 1800s. The media we look at now. Even then, most of the including Times, the New York Times to every other newspaper, a major newspaper in the world, used to carry advertisements on the front page. They came with the capitalist age. I mean, the media, as you see it, the conventional media, we think we take it for granted. It's only 150 years old. The shape it is in. It's going to die. Because many other institutions are dying, it's going to die. Media, it's already dying. It's in the last throes. It will come up in some other form. And relations with our writers also, is there any hierarchy? I'm trying to explain this at length because at every stage in, we have had professors belonging to the Republican background who have written to mainstream newspapers and to journals who have been rejected. Even though the content was so very, critical, it was sent on critical issues, crucial issues, national issues, which should have been, these voices should have been published. So there is a hierarchy in provincial media. They can decide, whatever editor, deputy editor, or assistant editor, or whoever in the pecking order can dismiss off, very serious, very senior, and very knowledgeable writers from Bengali background without thinking, twice, every time. And this happens all the time. This is an everyday thing. Lots of our younger writers also are deluded to think that, we send articles here, then the write will be published there. And then they are sent back. So we have to tell them that, RTI would have existed if these people published us. They don't publish the majority. They don't publish the Dalita, the OBC, or the, it keep talking of the Unnial survey where, 1% were Dalits, actually 3% were, 4% were OBCs, and those would be the Gamdas or the Okaligas or Lingayats. Lingayats would be there. So, and the rest of the 2,500 OBC castes would be there, and none of the 1,100 Dalit castes would be there, except for Gopal Guru sir, who has come in now, EPW. So, there is no other Dalit in such a prominent space. So Baba sir, we have to think here, what exactly is the mainstream or mainstream media, and what exactly are we, I have explained what we are, how we function. Baba sir said to the quote, journalism in India was once a profession. He must have said this 80 years ago or so. It has now become a trade. It has no moral function than the manufacture of soap. Actually, the first front page newspaper, front page would be occupied by soap advertisements in his time particularly. So it does not regard itself as a responsible advisor of the public to give the news uncolored by any motive to present a certain point view of public policy which it believes to be the good for the community, to correct and chastise or fear all those, no matter how high, who have chosen a wrong or barren path, is not regarded by journalism in India its first or foremost duty. But Baba sir was being very kind to them by calling it a trade. It was never their profession. They were the earliest, the first Telugu newspaper, the Andhra Patrika, daily newspaper, they started by a Brahmin. Every other newspaper has been started by Brahmin, the Deccan Chronicle to Deccan Herald, and all of the newspapers in the south, the Hindu, here, of course, the British started it, but it was taken over the money as the Times of India. And many of this Sunday Standard, Indian Express was started by again the British, and Goenka bought it, I think. The Goenka, original Goenka. And Hindustan Times was actually started by again Banias. And we know that it is not just the Hindu which has the segregation, which keeps out the non-vegetarians from their spaces. We know for a fact that most of the, from Bombay to Delhi to Patna, Jagran to Rajasthan Patrika to Amar Ujala to everyone, they have much more rigid ways of keeping out the unwashed or the unclean or the impure. They don't look beyond the Brahmin and Vaishya. All other castes, even if they were a caste or someone else, they would be regarded as kind of impure. And all of these spaces, even not just meat, the stricter vegetarian rules regarding use of onions and other things. The candles are not used. Allowed. So we have this kind of media, and it is called mainstream media. How much of the mainstream's, majorities lies can be brought out by these people, you will have to understand. That is, they are a very small minority, we have to accept that. In their practices, in their form, in their traditions, in their ownership, in their viewpoints, everything is Brahminical. How can you keep calling them mainstream? I don't understand. And whether it is neoliberal or not neoliberal, I don't know, because somebody was asking me, neoliberal kya hota hai? Nehru had all the money for starting IITs. Now he has no money for, he had no money for starting schools. Yeah, he said, I have no money for starting schools. He wanted all money for IITs and IISc and all of those places, half of them established by the Tatas and and they took it over. But he had no space for third rate students or reserved category students. He called them third rate students. He didn't want a third rate nation. They have been very definite, very honest about what they write about, who they write about, who they mean by India and Indian. So why don't you keep calling them mainstream media? And you have a media studies department here. I've asked other people also, sociology professors in other central universities. And you should say you study class, what do you study? And you should say you study media, what do you study? You vegetarianism, non-vegetarianism, is this what you study? And there is a and this loose terms like neoliberal and all that which the West applies. West men, 95% or 97% of the people are employed in manufacturing and services. In some places, the public sector, the government itself employs 65% to 35%. The lowest is 60%. India, the government employs 1.5%, nearly 3% actually speaking, 3%. So outside this public sector, there is no secure space for anyone. Everyone else is informal. Everyone has to start his life every day anew. Everyone has to find a new kind of job every day.